Hi. Today I'm going to make a video over for 6B, and I did it already, some of it, and then I accidentally deleted it, and so I'm redoing it. This happens to me all the time. I am a recording idiot. But anyway, the point I want to make on these first few problems is that they're the same as we did at the end of homework 6A. So I'm not going to be working through those every time. This one, the adults have a mean of 105 and a standard deviation for 20 for their IQ scores. And so they ask us to find the fourth percentile, which would separate the 4.04 and the 0.96. And so we would go into inverse normal, enter that area that's to the left of our line, and then the 105 and 20, and then you'd get 69.99. That one happens to be 3.17, which we did before. And then the next two are actually number 17 and 18 off of homework 6A. So if you have trouble with these, go back to 6A and watch just the very end of that video, and I work through these in detail. It might be different numbers, but it's very much the same. And the answers to that are there, and the course ID, the question ID is 6321. And then number three also is. But number four is different. We're finally on, these are all out of 6-3. They're all finally on to 6-4 in this problem. And I had talked through this over here, and kind of probably would make more sense if I talked through it the first time, but I'm gonna go through it again. There are four wealthy people, the four wealthiest people in billions, 44 billion, 28 billion, 18 billion, and 13 billion. Assume that sample sizes of N2 are randomly selected with replacement from this population of four values. So we're going to choose one of those four values, we're going to put it back, and then we're going to choose another one. So here's all the things that could happen. It could be that I reach and choose that randomly, get 44, and put it back, and then pull out a second one and get 44 again. The average of these two things, 44 plus 44 divided by 2, is 44. That's where they get that. We're going to see that there's a total of 16 different outcomes. We know that that's true because remember, when there's only two outcomes, N is 2, then we do four of those, we have four outcomes, and there's two choices, so 4 to the second power, which means there's 16 different outcomes. But anyway, so then we do the second one. I could pull out 44 person, put it back in, and then pull out the next person, could be that they're 28 billion millionaire, and so that average is 44 plus 28 divided by 2 is 36. That's where they get that. That's the average of those two. But don't forget, this average could happen because we got 44 and then we got 28, but it also could happen because we got 28 and then we got 44. Both of those would have the same average, right? And that's why I have 2 over here, because there's two ways to get two numbers that average to 36. It could be that I pull out a person who gets 44 billion and then put them back in, and then pull out another person who has 18 billion. And so if I add 44 and 18 and divide by 2, I get 31. And remember, I could do 44 and then the 18, or I could do 18 and then the 44. And that's why there's two different ways to get that. And then I could pull out 44 followed by 13. And if I add those and divide by 2, I get 28.5. And I could do 13 and 44 as well, which means there's two ways to get that one. It could be that I don't pull out 44 the first time, I pull out 28 the first time, and then 28 followed by 28 would be an average of 28. But if I pulled out 28 and 44, I've already accounted for that. 28 and 18 has an average of 23. But so does 18 and 28. I hope you see the what's happening here. 28 followed by 13 has an average of 20.5, but so does 13 followed by 20, so there's two of those. 18 is 18. 18 followed by 13 is 15.5, which is the same as 13 followed by 18, so there's two of those, and then 13 followed by 13. If you count these up, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15, there are 16 different outcomes. How many times does 44 come up? One time. There's only one out of 16 times that you get that, which is equivalent to 0.0625. How many times does 36 come up? Twice, so that's 2/16. 31, 2/16, 28.5, 2/16, 28, 1/16, and so forth all the way down the list. The answers are either 1/16 or 2/16. That's all we had. How did I find the mean of this? I went into my calculator, and in L1, I entered those values on the left, 44, 36, 31, and so forth. In my L2 column, I entered these values, 0.0625, 0.125, 0.125, which is 1/8 or 2/16. And so I entered all those. So I hopefully still have that in my data set since I just did this. Let's look at the data. Yeah, you can see I've got 44, 36, 31, 28.5, and over on the right, I have those values. And so I'm going to do this second function data, go down one to variable stats, hit enter, and in my first column, L1, is that data, and in my second column is my frequency, that's the probability that that comes up, so my probability is in column 2, and then I hit calculate, and I get 25.75 for my mean. And then it asks, is the mean of the sampling distribution from part B equal to the mean of the population of the listed four values? The mean of the listed four values is 44 plus 28 plus 18 plus 13 divided by 2, which turns out to be 25.75. So they are the same. So yes, because the mean of the sample means is equal to the mean of the population. And these means are always equal because the mean is an unbiased estimator, which means it works to use that when you're estimating things by looking at sample means. So what this means is the mean of the sample means. That's kind of a mouthful, right? It means if we take a bunch of different two samples like we did, we have a bunch of samples, and we have the means of those samples, and then we could take the average of all those samples or the mean of all those sample means and get that. And the mean is a good estimator for that. So it is an unbiased estimator because the mean of the population, which is this, we just had those four things in our population, the mean of that is equal to the mean of those samples that we do. So that's number four. Moving on to number five. When two births are randomly selected, the sample space for gender is either boy-boy, boy-girl, girl-boy, or girl-girl. Assume that those four outcomes are equally likely and construct a table that describes the sampling distribution of the sample portion of girls from two births. Does the mean of the sample proportion equal the proportion of girls in two births? Does the result suggest that a sample proportion is an unbiased estimator of a population proportion? So there's three different things that can happen here. You could have zero girls. That's the first thing we said, was that you could have two boys, which means you have zero girls. How often does that happen? Well, there's four different outcomes, and that happens one out of four times, or 0.25. One out of four times that happens. You could have one girl. That happens if you have boy-girl or girl-boy. There's two different ways for that to happen. So you could have half of your two could be, half of them could be girls. And how often does that happen? Well, it happens two out of four times, so half the time. And then we have that you could have two girls. In that case, all of your girls, the whole sample space, which adds up to one, the whole sample space is girls. And that happens, again, one time out of four, because there's four different things, right? That happens when you have girl, girl. So that happens also 1/4 of the time. So 1/4 of the time, you'll just get boys. 1/4 of the time, you'll just get girls. And half the time, you get one of each. Okay, does the mean of the sample portion equal the proportion of the girls in two births? Well, the girls in two births, when you average these up, the mean of the sample proportion is equal to the mean of the sample proportions are these. So if we take the average of those, we get that, and they're both 1/2. The mean is going to be 1/2. In two births, there's a 50-50, you get 1/2, right? So it's always 1/2 for that. And it's also 1/2 when we look at the, if you look at the sample proportion mean, you have 1/2 plus 0 plus 1/2. You're doing this, the probability. Let's do it. I don't think that I'm explaining that very well. Let's do the data. Is there an L4? No, just L1 in this. Well, there's limitations to an inexpensive calculator. No biggie. So I have a sample space. Either I could have 0 or 0.5 or 1. Is that going to work in this calculator? It might give me an error. Let's see. My probability is 0.25, 0.5, and 0.25. And if I do this, L1 and L2, and hit calculate, it gives me 0.5. So when I take the mean of this, here's my sample space. If I take the mean of that, I get 0.5. And on the other hand, if I take the average of the population, there's always a 0.5 chance that girls are going to be born. So does the result suggest that a sample proportion is an unbiased estimate? Turns out yes, because the proportion of girls in the sample's proportion is the same as the proportion of girls in the population. So it's also an unbiased estimator, the proportion as well as the girls. The mean and the proportion are a good unbiased estimators. Okay, the population of current statistics students has ages with mean mu and standard deviation sigma. Samples of statistics students are randomly selected so that there are exactly 40 students in each sample. For each sample, the mean age is computed. What does the central limit theorem tell us about the distribution of those mean ages? Because when you're talking about the central limit theorem, you're talking about having a sample that's 30 or more. So it's greater than 30. And so we have 40, so we're all set with that. And then if we have that, then we can approximate the mean ages by taking the standard deviation divided by the square root of n. That's the central limit theorem tells us, that because we have more than 30, we can the sampling distribution of the mean ages can be approximated by just taking the standard deviation divided by the square root of 40. And that puts us into section 6.5. Okay. Assume that women's heights are normally distributed with a mean given by 64.4 inches and a standard deviation given by 2.6 inches. If one woman is randomly selected from the probability that, find the probability that her height is less than 65 inches. These are two different things that they're asking for here. And since the B part is kind of the new part, I'm going to do this small over here and then I'll do the bigger side over here. So this is A over here. What's actually happening here? We have a normal distribution. I shouldn't be flipping up on the end. I tend to do that. We know the mean and the standard deviation. What's the probability that her height is less than 65 inches? Here's mean, 64.4. So 65.5 is just barely to the right of that, but it's a little bit to the right. And what we're asking is, what's the probability that she is less than 65 inches tall? That is, what's all this area under here? We know the number below, so we're going to use the normal CDF to find that the area to the left. And so what we know is that our mean is 64.4 and our standard deviation is 2.6. And we also know that we're going from negative infinity, up to 65. And that's what you're going to put in your calculator to find the normal CDF of that. And this is what you're going to get when you do that. I've done that so many times, and I'm going to let you do that on your own. But 0.5910 suggests that about 59% of the time, somebody would be 65 inches or less tall. Now, that's if we select one person. What if we select 41 women? Then we need to find the standard deviation of the mean, is what I'm used to calling it anyway. And that means we need to say, well, you know, as the numbers get bigger, greater than 30, we expect that those sample means are really going to start becoming really close to the actual mean. So it's different than just looking at one person who could be really extremely tall or really extremely short, and we got an oddball in the group. Maybe we did that if we had one, but if we have 41, the odd ones are going to average each other out, and we're not going to have that extreme. So what we do is we just take our standard deviation and we divide by the square root of our n. Standard deviation is 2.6. This is the central limit theorem that we're talking about here. We just saw it. And then we have the square root of n, and that was 41 women. So we take the square root of 41. That gives us a new standard deviation. Let me get out of that. 2.6 divided by second function square root 41. Is 0.4061. I'm going to go to four places, and I don't know, because they're asking us to go to four overall. What that means is now when I go to my normal seat, okay, I'm doing this still. Have a normal distribution. I want to know what's the probability that they have a height less than 65 inches. Here is my mean, which is 64.4. Here's my 65 inches, and I want to know what's this. But the big difference here, I want to ask the same question, but I've got 41 people. So when I do my normal CDF, I've got a mu of 64.4, but instead of entering that old standard deviation, I'm entering the one that I just found, which is 0.4061, and then I have the same thing, negative infinity up to 65, and that's going to change things because I have changed the standard deviation. Of course it's going to change things, but normal CDF, my mean was 64.4 in both cases. Now it's 0.4061, and I'm talking about from the lower bound up to 65, and that gives me 0.9302. Again, I rounded that off. Maybe I shouldn't have. Maybe they have the tolerance for that. But while notice that it's 59% chance if it's one person, but if you get a whole bunch of people, it's becoming a 93% chance, or very likely that it's going to happen if you get all those people. 41 people is going to really make that probable going to happen. So this is the extra thing for the part B, that we have to find that and enter that as our new standard deviation, as opposed to the original one that we had, which was 26. That's kind of fun. Okay, an overhead reach distances of adult females are normally distributed with a mean of 197.5 centimeters and a standard deviation of 8.6 centimeters. Find the probability that an individual distance is greater than 210.90. Again, we're talking about greater than in this one. So if we were to look at that in a picture form, our normal mean is 197.5. That's here. And 210 is over here a ways, right? So we're going to say that's 210. But in this case, we're saying, what's the chance that it's greater than? So we're looking for the distance to the right, right? And so, hang on, I'm losing my light again. I have to do something to make that come on. Okay, so if I have one individual, I'm finding an area, so it's a normal CDF, and what I know here is my mean is 197.5, my standard deviation is 8.6. I'm starting on the left at 210.90, and I'm going to the right to 1, I don't want to make that look like a negative. I'm going up to 1e99 or 1 to the infinity. And that answer turns out to be 0.0596 because there's not as many people that are going to be way over here on the right. When I pick more people, in this case they're going to say 15, is it going to be a higher probability or a lower? Well, this was unusual to occur for one person. So 15 people having that average, that'd be super unusual. Do you see that probability should go down because we aren't going to find 15 oddballs all at once. And I don't mean to call them oddballs in a bad way, but 15 outlier type of people. And finding one and having a really small 6% chance is okay. But when we go back and do this, now I'm going to ask about what about 15? So I'm going to find that alternate standard deviation and standard deviation of the mean. And that is my standard deviation 8.6 divided by the square root of 15 because that's my sample size. And when I find that 8.6 divided by the square root of 15, then I get 2.22 as my standard deviation. Now look how different that is than the standard deviation of 86, right? So now when I go back and do my normal CDF, my mean stays the same. My standard deviation now is 2.22, and I am going from 210.90 up to 1e to the 99th. But the thing that changes here is this piece right there that we had to calculate. And so that becomes... Find the probability is, oh, I did it for 110, but I didn't read the problem. So if it was the same as 210, we would have expected it to go down. But look what they asked instead. Find the probability for the mean of 15 randomly selected distances is greater than 196. So right here, I should have put 196 in, sorry. 196 is less than the mean. So here's what they asked for the A part, which is rare, right? But here's what they asked for the B part, and I'm sorry, I just assumed. I've been working out of a different textbook for a while, and they never do that. They always have the same number. I should not make that assumption, but it's good to be called back to earth. So our mean is 197.5. So 196 is over here to the left of that, right? And so we're looking at what's the chance that they are going to be greater than that. So we have anybody that's all this. And so that's a different question entirely than what they asked up above, right? And so that's why we get that. Let's put it in just now, just because you probably have no faith in me whatsoever after that. Normal CDF, 197.5, 2.22. Again, I rounded that, so it might look a little different. 196 up to infinity, and we get 0.75403 in this case. So just be careful, look at that closely. Why can the normal distribution be used in part B even though the sample size does not exceed 30? Well, the original population that we're working with is normally distributed. And if it's normally distributed, then we can do that. So it's the original population has a normal distribution. So our sample size can be smaller because we're drawing from a population that already we know is normally distributed, so it's okay to do that. So that's that. That would be D. That's 65.7. Okay, now let's go on. The capacity of an elevator is 12 people or 2,028 pounds. The capacity will be exceeded if 12 people have weights with a mean greater than 169. So that's taking, excuse me, taking the total capacity dividing by 12 people, 169 pounds per person. Suppose the people have weights that are normally distributed with a mean of 176 pounds and a standard deviation of 27 pounds. Find the probability that if a person is randomly selected, his weight will be greater than 169 pounds. Okay. So, here's the problem. We are getting fatter as a society. We all have these little extra rolls around our guts and stuff. And so what used to be considered, okay, we can assume that everybody's going to average about 169, we cannot make that assumption anymore. There's a lot of us that weigh more than 169. So this is the kind of thing that mathematicians are asked. We don't want elevators to start collapsing and killing people because we made bad assumptions. We have to go out and find this data and make sure that we're putting capacities on elevators and things like that that mean that we can actually all get on them and feel safe while we do it. So this is kind of a thing. So anyway, it's the same type of thing though. We have this standard deviation, and the mean is 169, or the mean is 176 for our sample, and the standard deviation of 27 pounds. Find the probability that a person is randomly selected, his weight will be greater than 169. So 169, you know it's got to be over here, and we're looking for one person. What's the what's the chance that that happens? So we're talking about a normal CDF, because we're looking at to find the percentage. We have a mean given of 176. We have a standard deviation given of 27. And we're going from 169 up to infinity. And when you put that into the calculator, you get 0.6023. What's the probability that 12 randomly selected people will have a mean that is greater than 169? Here, they are using the same number, thankfully, so we can think of the same picture, but what do we have to do extra? We have to take the standard deviation of 27 and divide by the square root of, how many people are we taking? 12, square root of 12, and that's going to give us a new standard deviation of the mean to look at, second function square root 12, and that, I forgot to put decimal in there, 27 divided by second function square root 12. If your calculator, you want a decimal, you just put a decimal at the end, and then it says, oh, you want the decimal answer. 7.7, that doesn't make any sense, does it? Oh, yeah, that's our mean. Okay, I thought that was the final answer. Made no sense, because remember, the area under the curve equals 1, so we can't ever get 7. All right, so we're going to say that's 7.7942. So now we're going to do normal CDF again. We have the same mean, but we have a different standard deviation to put in there. And then we're still going from 169 up to infinity. And that comes out to be 0.8174. So there's more chance of people, if we have that many people, that's a greater probability that we're gonna have a average that's more than 169. Does the elevator appear to have the correct weight limit? Well, there's an 82% chance that people are not gonna be in making weight for that elevator, if you think about it that way. So that means that if everybody gets on, and the averages that we're looking at, 82% of the time, the elevator could be overloaded, which could put a stress on it and cause accident. So no, there's a good chance that 12 randomly selected people will exceed the elevator capacity. And that's bad mojo. So we need to change the capacity on that, maybe only say limit of 10 people or something to get on. We could figure that out, but that's not what the question is. Okay. The weight of a certain brand of candies have a mean weight of, a certain brand of candies have a mean weight of 0.8585 grams and a certain standard deviation of 0.0524. Based on a sample of a package containing 468 candies, the mean weight of candies must exceed 0.8531 for the net contents to weigh at least 399.3. Okay, so this, let me just say what we're saying here. They're putting 468 candies in there, and they want the package to have an average of 0.8531. That's what it is. There's a standard deviation in there. Okay. If a candy is randomly selected, find the probability that it weighs more than 8531. Okay, so we're just thinking about this. We have this distribution. The average weight is 0.8585. We want to know the probability that it weighs more than 8531, which is just slightly over here to the left. Why do I draw a picture? Because I need to know what I'm actually thinking about. When I get my answer, I like to see, does that make sense? I do this wrong sometimes, but the picture like stops me like, whoa, wait a second, how could I get that? And so if I plug in my normal CDF, and I have the mean of 8585, the standard deviation of 0.0524, and I'm going from 0.8531 up to infinity, then I get an answer of 0.5398. If 468 candies are selected, why'd they pick that? Because that's how many they put in a bag. What's the probability that their mean weight is at least 0.8531? If it's at least, it's saying the same thing, that it's greater than or equal to. That's the smallest, or it could go up. So it's the same thing, the same picture for us. But we do have to do this thing, which is take our standard deviation, 0.0524, and divide by the square root of 468. And that gives us the number then that we're going to put into our calculator instead of the standard deviation 0.0524. I'm not going to write that down because we've done it quite a bit. So we're going to do, there's a 0.9871 chance. That's the answer for that. You could try it out and see if you get it. The 98 or almost 99% chance that the candies selected will have a mean weight that's at least 8531, could be more. Nobody's ever going to complain if they get extra candy, right? So we don't want it to go under that, but it's okay if it's more than that. That's 0.9871. Given these results, does it appear that the candy company is providing consumers with the amount claimed on the label? 99% of the time they are. 1% of the time somebody gets ripped off, maybe misses a couple of grams there. But yeah, it looks like they are to me, because the probability of getting a sample mean this or greater when you have 400 candies is not exceptionally small. It's actually quite large. 99% of the time you get that. So it looks like the people are giving their customers what they say they're going to give them. All right. Women have pulse rates that are normally distributed with a mean of 78.5 beats per minute and a standard deviation of 11.7 beats per minute, complete parts A through C. Find percentiles, the first percentile and the 99 percentile. And this one now, we're 6.5, we're still in 6.5. Okay. Complete parts, find the percentile, Okay, so what are we talking about when we talk about a one percentile? Well, we're talking about that area way over here. We have 1% here and we have 99% over here, right? 1% is this little tiny blip over there. We know that our mean is 78.5 and our standard deviation is 11.7, and we want to find this score down there, okay? So we are going to use inverse normal to do that. And we have our mean, and we have our standard deviation, and we have our area is 0.01. Remember, we're always looking to the left of that. So let's see, 51.3, let's go on and do that. We haven't done inverse normal for a little bit. So our area is 0.01. Our mean is 78.5, and our standard deviation is 11.7. And that gives us 51.3. And then what about the 99th percentile? Well, now we're doing 99th percentile. It's different because now we're talking about the 99% over here separating the 1% over there. So we are talking about 99th percentile. So instead of 0.01 here, our area, our alpha, is 0.99. And so that gives us the 105.7. Does that make sense based on our mean? Well, our mean right down the middle is 78.5. So it makes sense that if we're 99th percentile, we have something that's higher. So that means somebody's coming in with this pulse rate of 105.7, and we would say that it's an unusual pulse rate because she's all the way up there at 99th percentile. Remember, 95% is the kind of, we're talking about normal. Okay, actually, not when we're talking about percentile, so let me just back off that. But, you know, we talked about normal ranges, two standard deviations, which is 95% of the population fall into that. A doctor sees exactly 25 patients each day. Find the probability that 25 randomly selected women have a mean pulse rate between 67 and 91. So we want this down here at 67, up here at 91. We're trying to find this area. We know that our mean is 78.5, but we're talking about 25 people, so we have to do this thing where we divide by the people that we see. And the standard deviation originally was 11.7. So I'm gonna let you calculate that, but it's gonna be a normal CDF where we know what the mean is, we know this the mean standard deviation of the mean, and we know our lower and upper boundaries, and so we're gonna calculate that, and we get one. The probability that the pulse rates are going to be are between 67 and 91 is like almost 100%. So my drawing's not very good, right? Because it should span out wider. 67 and 91 pretty much covers almost everybody. So there you go. All right, C. Oh, I didn't answer the question. The answer is C, obviously. What's the question? If a doctor wants to select pulse rates to be used as cutoff values for determining when further tests should be required, which pulse rates are better to use? The results from Part A or the pulse rates of 67 and 91 beats per minute? Why? Because if the doctor was going to decide what to use, they want to think about you as an individual. So you would be using the values, I think, yeah, from the individual results that you got, not from the mean. Because when you have a mean, it just looks like the normal distribution from anything. So I think you would be wanting to use, yeah, you'd be wanting to use the cutoff values that are based on individual patients because you're looking at an individual. So you want to use the individual information. All right, number 12. How many do we have in this? Well, it's going on and on and on, taking me forever. The normal quartile plot to the right represents duration times in seconds of eruptions of a certain geyser from an accompanying data set. Examine the normal quartile plot and determine whether it depicts sample data from a population with a normal distribution. And then you have to look at the data down below. So time is getting away from me here. I'm gonna have to stop for now. There's 18, 19 questions. I don't have time to finish this. So let's stop now after number 11. And I'll come back and finish this video tomorrow when I come back. So.